Tendermint was the first BFT-based proof-of-stake consensus mechanism, created by Jay Kwon and his team in 2014. To give a bit of historical context, Tendermint brought with it the academic rigor of more traditional consensus mechanisms such as PBFT, Paxos, and Raft to a space that was at the time mostly dominated by newer blockchain consensus mechanisms, namely proof-of-work and other Nakamoto consensus mechanisms. In the beginning, Tendermint was an all-inclusive proof-of-stake system with its own native token to drive incentive, but since then, it has evolved to become a more generalized middleware for replicating applications on many machines. This allows developers to write their own applications and business logic in any language. These applications talk to what's called the Application Blockchain Interface, which in turn talks to the Tendermint Core Consensus Engine. You can see a diagram of the state machine on the right. Tendermint is energy efficient and fast, but currently is still testing scalability to a large number of validators. So today, it's primarily being used in production in private permissioned environments. It's also the backbone of the Cosmos network, which aims to create the internet of blockchains and fix the problem of blockchains existing in silos, unable to communicate with one another. In Tendermint, we have a globally known and predefined validator set. Consensus proceeds in three rounds, and at each round, more than two-thirds of the entire validator set must vote for the proposed block in order to proceed to the next round. Otherwise, if we don't hear from validators within a certain time, we count their vote as nil. And this reliance on a timeout makes Tendermint a weekly synchronous protocol rather than an asynchronous one. And because it's BFT-based, Tendermint favors consistency over availability. Validators wait for each other to vote or time out and come to consensus before the state of the application is updated. All right, so let's run through a little demo to see how the Tendermint consensus engine runs at a high level. On the right, we have a state machine diagram for Tendermint, and on the left, we have our little demo network. If you've taken the first course in the Blockchain Fundamentals program, Bitcoin and Cryptocurrencies, then this diagram should be pretty familiar to you. So here's how things work. At each new block height, a validator is chosen to propose a new block. We've circled this in red. If we were using Tendermint for proof of stake, like how Cosmos does it, the validator would be chosen at random based on their proportion of bonded token. Then, in the first round, called pre-vote, the rest of the validators can either pre-vote the block or pre-vote nil. Pre-voting the block indicates that the validator marked the block as valid. Pre-voting nil either means that the validator marked the block as invalid or failed to respond within time, possibly due to network timeout, power outage, or some other arbitrary reason. If we receive more than two-thirds pre-votes, that's called a polka, hence the image of the two people dancing in the bottom right corner. Then, in the next step, is pre-commit. If a validator witnesses a two-thirds pre-vote for the block from the network and pre-voted for the block, then it pre-commits the block. Otherwise, if the validator pre-voted nil previously because the block was invalid, or they simply didn't pre-vote in time, then the validator pre-commits nil. If two-thirds validators pre-commit the block, then the block is committed. Else, a new voting round starts. We start off in the new height phase. In this step, we select a validator to propose the new block. Tendermint does this with a round-robin selection algorithm that selects proposers in order of their voting power, which in the case of proof-of-stake is however much every validator decided to stake. Let's say Rusty gets chosen as the proposer. So in the propose phase, he proposes the next block. That's the yellow block on top of his name. The next phase is to pre-vote. Since we have five validators, we need at least four of us to pre-vote the block that he proposed in order to reach the greater than two-thirds threshold. So we wait for a bit of time for all of the pre-votes to come in. Remember that Tendermint is partially synchronous, so we stop waiting after the timeout time has passed and just take whatever pre-votes we have so far and assume the rest are pre-vote nil. Let's say everyone pre-votes for the block before time's up, which means that we have 5 out of 5 pre-votes for the block, and that's more than two-thirds. And yay, that's a polka! Alright, so now we're on the next phase, which is pre-commit. Everyone who originally voted pre-vote block in the last phase should be voting pre-commit block this time around, so let's see what happens. Uh-oh, looks like there was a network partition, and both Nadir, myself, and Nick are separated from the rest of the network. Maybe my computer crashed and Nick's neighborhood had a blackout. So everyone pre-commits, and Derek, Gloria, and Rusty all pre-commit the block. Meanwhile, since no one's heard from neither Nick nor myself yet, and it's past the timeout time, we count those votes as pre-commit nil. So this time, we have 3 out of 5 pre-commits for the block, which isn't more than 2/3 of the total number of validators. All right, so since we didn't get more than 2/3 pre-commits for the block, we can't commit the block Rusty proposed, so we have to go to a new round. As mentioned earlier, Tendermint's proposer selection algorithm is round robin, so it can't choose me to propose again. The algorithm is also proportional based on the amount of voting power we have. So let's say Derek staked the second highest amount after Rusty, so he's the next to be able to propose a block. So that's the yellow block on top of his name here. And let's say that I managed to reboot my crashed computer and I'm back online as a validator. This time around, if everyone pre-votes and pre-commits the block all within time, and no one crashes or fails in any other way, then we have 4 out of 5, which is more than 2/3, so we could potentially commit this next block. And if Nick continues to be offline, his stake could be slashed. Casper is a very intentional pun for being the spiritual successor of Ghost. To preface, the Ghost protocol is Ethereum's solution to its fast block times. Fast block times, when compared to block propagation rates and latency, mean that there will be more naturally occurring forks and such. Valid blocks that are verified by part of the network might end up being cast off because it lost the propagation race to another equally valid block. These castaway blocks are called uncle blocks, and while they might not in the end be included in the longest chain, they do represent the fact that there was some degree of computation done on them. So, the Ghost protocol includes these uncle blocks into the calculation of which chain has had the most cumulative work done on it, serving as a fork resolution policy for miners. Casper is a planned upgrade to Ethereum that's an adaptation of some of the principles of the Ghost protocol for proof of work into proof of stake. This upgrade from proof of work to proof of stake has long been in planning, pretty much ever since the Ethereum Yellow Paper was written in 2014, and evidence for which has been publicly viewable in the form of the Ethereum Ice Age and Difficulty Bomb, both of which are artificial limitations on the Ethereum software that have been purposely placed in the protocol so as to force a hard fork years later. The first steps to upgrade Ethereum from proof of work to proof of stake will likely be a proof of stake overlay on top of the existing proof of work protocol. We'll talk about this in the next slide, but Casper the Friendly Finality Gadget, an implementation of Casper in the form of an Ethereum smart contract, is set to launch with a 2-year plan and 1.2 million Ether in funding. There are two big implementations of Casper, each taking a different approach. Casper the Friendly Finality Gadget, or Casper FFG, is a proof-of-stake overlap on top of proof-of-work. It's a chain and BFT-based proof-of-stake hybrid, and is taking a stepwise approach to upgrading Ethereum, with the ultimate goal of eventually casting away Ethereum's proof-of-work scaffolding entirely. On the other hand, Casper the Friendly Ghost is a member of a family of consensus protocols derived from a correct by construction, or CBC, methodology. Sometimes you'll hear Casper the Friendly Ghost being referred to as CBC Casper. CBC means that this implementation of Casper was designed by scratch to formally satisfy a certain safety proof. So it's correct by construction. It's a pure proof-of-stake protocol, not a hybrid like Casper FFG, and when in implementation, would require a much more drastic overhaul. As we mentioned earlier, Casper FFG is a proof-of-work and proof-of-stake hybrid. It's known colloquially as Vitalik's Casper, since he's the main advocate of this form of Casper. Casper FFG is a proof-of-stake overlay on top of proof-of-work that, as its name implies, is a tool that aims to fix finality in Ethereum. In Bitcoin, Ethereum, and many other proof-of-work blockchains, we rely on the probabilistic finality of blocks. For example, in Bitcoin, we assume the blocks are finalized with reasonable probability if that block has more than 6 confirmations on top of it. Though it's unlikely for the block to be forked by a longer chain, the probability will always exist. Hence, the longest chain is never truly final in Bitcoin. FFG attempts to take away that probabilistic finality from proof-of-work systems. In FFG, we carry on with proof-of-work as normal. However, every 50 blocks, called an epoch, we run a round of proof-of-stake, which consists of prepare and commit phases, where validators vote on which chain they believe to be canonical. Each round of proof-of-stake at an epoch is called a checkpoint, and checkpoints are first justified, and then if another checkpoint is built on top of it, then that previous checkpoint is considered finalized. If block B is finalized, then the blockchain cannot reasonably revert back to a time in history before block B. This is also advantageous because we can now consider only the justified chain rather than the entire Ethereum blockchain. Casper FFG also implements deposits and slashing conditions. We'll explain these in next week's lecture about proof of stake and crypto economics. On the other hand, Casper the Friendly Ghost is colloquially known as Vlad's Casper, named after Vlad Zamfir, cryptography researcher. As we mentioned before, it is designed from the ground up with a correct by construction, or CBC, methodology. So it would be a more drastic overhaul to the Ethereum network, aiming to redefine the fundamentals of the protocol. CBC Casper is a family of protocols that allow consensus on different types of data, but all satisfy the same safety proof. Currently, there are six consensus protocols that exist in the CBC family, which serve purposes ranging from binary and ordinal consensus to list and concurrent schedule consensus and blockchain consensus. Instead of aiming for probabilistic finality, as with Bitcoin, CBC Casper aims for absolute finality. Most Nakamoto consensus networks, because of the fork resolution policies they adopt, allow for extremely historic chains to be overridden by even longer forks. A miner in Iceland secretly mining an incredibly long blockchain, which took more computational power to produce, could invalidate the entire Bitcoin blockchain any day. This is because Nakamoto consensus assumes that the probability of an event happening is incredibly low. However, it's never completely impossible. CBC Casper, on the other hand, achieves eventual finality. This means that, after some point in time, a block will eventually be finalized and immutable. Though the time to finality could be unbounded, it is still a finite amount of time. This is the subject of much present-day research, and it may change even soon within the future. To best understand cutting-edge developments such as these, it's best to explore by yourself for the best understanding. It's difficult to get into the details with so much theory to understand, but recognizing the gist of the difference between probabilistic finality and absolute finality, and the differences between how the two types of Casper achieve finality, are the most important takeaways for this particular section.